Good morning to one and all present here. I am Janhavi Mure. I welcome you all to this program arranged by Science Club University Science Colloquium in association with Department of Botany, Savitribai Phule Pune University. On behalf of Botany Department, I would like to convey my hearty welcome to our guest of honor, Professor R.K. Kohli, Vice Chancellor of Central University of Punjab, Professor Avinash Kumbhar, Professor S.R. Gadre, to this program. Now, I would like to request Professor Avinash Kumbhar to enlighten us about the Science Club.
Good morning and a warm welcome to all of you on behalf of the Science Club, Savitribai Phule Pune University Science Club, as we call it. We arrange programs, and mainly our program is a colloquium by experts coming in the from various fields in science and giving us their opinion on various aspects. This is our second colloquium this semester. The first one was by Professor K.S. Valdia, who talked about excessive rainfall, unending landslides, and a restless Himalayan region. And that was also very well appreciated. And as you can see, today also, we have a huge crowd, which gives us a great pleasure saying that this is becoming a very popular series. Today we have Professor R.K. Kohli with us, who's going to talk on alien plant invasion in India. And I welcome you all for this this colloquium. The students must be wondering why one piece of A4 size paper has been given to them. We also have a competition. The student has to write a precis or a summary of the talk, which should not be which should be technical. Not that this was a very good lecture or this was very informative, but a real precis, and the best of them would be given a prize during the next colloquium that will be held on November 3rd in the physics department. So on behalf of Science Club, I welcome you all and hope you enjoy this lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your welcome speech. Now I request Minal Parmar to introduce today's guest of honor.
Hello, good morning everyone. I'm very privileged to introduce our guest of honor, Professor R.K. Kohli. He is Professor R.K. Kohli, MSc PhD recipient of J.C. Bose National Fellow, Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. He is the fellow of all four national science academies, has been appointed as second vice chancellor of University of Punjab with effect from September 5th, 2014. He has more than 35 years of experience and has been the Vice Chancellor of DAV University, Jalandhar. He is a renowned ecologist. He had been a member and chairman of academic, administrative, or technical committees of Botany Department in Punjab University. He has also chaired several academic bodies meetings in India and abroad. He has received Best Scientist Award of Haryana for 2008-09 from Government of Haryana. He has been nominated by Ministry of Environment, Government of India as Chairman of Expert Appraisal Committee for Environmental Clearance for any departmental activities for UT Chandigarh under EIA. He has received Punjab Ratan Award for Environment, Science and Education 2007-08. He is certified senior ecologist by Board of Professional Certification ESA USA 2005-15. He has received State of Honor for teaching and research in environment from UT Chandigarh Government 1998. He has received Nanda Memorial National Young Scientist Gold Medal Award for research in forestry 1988 and Vijayashree Award New Delhi 2006. Sir, we are honored to have you here, and now I request you to please deliver your talk. Thank you.
Loaded, Good day to all of you. Very dear students, respected Dr. Gadre, Professor Avinash, Madam Chairperson, my colleagues from this university, and members of the club. I must admit, I am very happy to have been invited to this place for multiple reasons. One and the foremost, that this is a club of the students, by the students, for the students. When I learned from Dr. Avinash about it, I was excited. I was just sharing it with Professor Gadre that I am also starting the same activity, the same principle. And today, just now sitting here, I also found that you have an activity of writing a piece on a piece of paper. This also I like, and I think I'll have to imbibe it. The second important issue which prompted me to come here is the university, Pune University. Very old institution. I have visited this place, not the department, but the Ayuka Center and other institutions, NCL, but not the university per se. So it was an opportunity which I thought I must take. And third, that the topic I have been given the task to discuss is an issue which is my area of, one of the four areas of my interest. I am basically a biochemist by training as a student, but by work I turned into an ecologist. I was asked to teach ecology when I joined Punjab University Chandigarh as a lecturer. I have never studied ecology. It was a challenge for me. I took it and started loving it. Now it is my first love, ecology. I introduced the knowledge of biochemistry into ecology and started with a topic called allelopathy. At that time, people felt that Dr. Kohli has become crazy. Nobody had heard the name of allelopathy. So from there, step by step, I grew, and by chance, the plants I worked on happened to be all non-Indian plants, alien plants. So in a way, and at that time nobody had heard the name invasive alien plants. It is later on that I kept on going to different countries for on conferences or for other activities and to give lectures and to correspondence, that today in ecology, invasive alien species is the much and the most prized problem the world over. I have published 3 books also on invasive ecology. I am getting good royalty out of these books. Allelopathy is the first that I published, and that also. And I used to go to different places to invite people, the young teachers, to take up this task of allelopathy. It is a simple issue, experimental issue. So I'll, with the help of these slides, I'll be talking on alien plant invasion in India. I have been asked not to be too technical. I will not be technical, but in case I use some such technical words and you do not understand, you know, raise your hand and I'll explain. I'll be very happy if some of you start thinking on this aspect, and the aspect which the international level, at the international level, people are demanding work on. You can get good amount of grants for working on this aspect. If permitted, should I start? I have divided this into 3-4 parts. First is the basic. Then, where are the problems in India? What are the challenges before us? And what we can do to stem this? You know, if I am permitted to say a corollary, that people say that India has never invaded any country. India has been invaded by many. I don't admit it. You know, you try to focus on Southall in England. Britishers, they have left the area. Pakistanis, Bangladeshis, Asians, majority Indians, they have overpowered the area, and Britishers, they have to leave. This is nothing but invasion. You know, hate crimes in USA, in Australia, in New Zealand, you must have heard in or read in the newspapers. These are also basic invasion. The simple issue, aliens, exotics, non-Indian, when they come to our area, initially everybody is goody-goody with them. You know, if somebody Japanese come to be a part of your classroom, American is a class fellow, you will be goody-goody with him or her. But when he invites others and they start taking, you know, positions, they start taking jobs, you will start competing. And then you will start saying, oh, he is an exotic, he is an alien. Why should we feed them? These are precisely the issues, even at the plant level, even at the avian fauna, animals, fishes. The same thing happens in every biological system. And this is not a new phenomenon. It had been occurring, it is occurring, and it will keep on. But the dimensions and speed rate has increased tremendously. There are reasons for it. They say that invasions have caused more species extinction than expected from climate change. I am just trying to give the summary first, and then I'll be moving further. It is the second leading cause of species extinction. Reasons, largely man-made. Better connectivity, opening up of economy, more aeroplanes, more travel, more export and import. Then facilitated by climate change and global warming, the conditions at the new place are becoming favorable. So the intruder is finding it comfortable. Likewise, these change in wind pattern, this is all reasons for this, why it has now gained momentum. Results into globalization, homogenization of biota. As an ecologist, maybe you are also aware that it will be a doomsday if there is homogenization of biota. Every plant, every organism, every animal is everywhere. Only those will survive who can dominate. Those who cannot dominate because of their intrinsic reasons, they will have to be wiped out, and it will be a tragedy. Then, you know, this will lead to ecosystem integrity loss, ecological disruptions, change in distribution and diversity of native vegetation, thus dependent insects. There will be a lot of chaos in a nutshell. 2009, by the CBD, Convention on Biodiversity, they had devoted the global attention on invasion, 2009. The issue is how to distinguish whether a plant or an animal has originated from this place or it is an exotic. It is a difficult task. There are certain possibilities by way of which one can identify whether a plant is an Indian plant or Australian plant or American. As I say that potential evidence for finding the origin of species, this is one of the possibilities from the paleontological data, but it is difficult. It takes a lot of time on a particular plant to establish its site of origin. Then second is biogeographical approach. On the basis of range of distribution and pattern, again it is not precise. Like dipterocarps, these big trees, they are available in India, they are available in Indo-Malayan region, they are available in Australia. The distribution is very wide. Whether they have come from Australia to this place, or they have gone from here to Australia, or for that matter Indo-Malayan region, Malaysia, etc. Of course, when we talk of this continental drift, Australia was part with us. Maybe it is possible. But it is just an example that there are plants which are widely distributed. So then Vavilov, you might have known about him, a Russian geneticist. He says that wherever there is more genetic diversity in area where the genetic diversity is more, it means that plant, the origin is that place. For example, mango, Mangifera indica. It is an Indian plant. Genetic diversity, around 6,000 something varieties are there. Or brinjal, bangan. The site of origin is Bihar and UP, etc. area. 265 varieties, koi kala, koi green, koi lamba, koi chota, koi mota, like that. So this could also be a criteria for analyzing whether a plant is of this origin or has come from outside. Invasion process is simple. First is introduction. Deliberate by man or by nature. Then is colonization. You know, you start imagining a person comes from Japan here, marries a Japanese girl, they have children, children stay here, they marry here, their next generations are here. They will adopt all your culture, the language, the food habits, the diseases also. So they colonize, they will invite more people, they will spread over. And then after acclimatization, they will get naturalized. So once they naturalize, they are exotic, naturalized species. Once they start competing with the natives, we say they have now invaded. Invading a new area, a king goes to a new area, captures it, overpowers it, and puts his own rules and regulations. So this is the same thing which is happening in all biological systems. Many organisms, they invade new area, but only some of them get established. Now I am looking at how it all happens, mechanisms of it. There are intrinsic inside and extrinsic outside factors which help in invasion or delaying invasion. And these two, extrinsic and intrinsic, you are science students, you understand the meaning of it. Then there are two different theories. One theory says that it is a balance of nature. You must have heard about oscillatory mechanisms in ecology. Example, let us say there are many rats in an area. Snakes will come in because food is available. Snakes will have good food, they will grow in size, they will grow better, they will reproduce better. Their number will increase, the number of rats will decrease. Then these snakes, they will starve, their reproductive ability will go down, their number will go down, the rats number will increase. So this type of oscillation keep on occurring in the system unless man interferes. So this is one theory which says that in nature nobody can invade us if we are strong. Anybody can invade us if we are poor and weak. The second is the theory of individualistic species response. At some places, the invader cannot come. At others, invader can come in. They say that both these theories are operative. Exclusion mein nahi hai ye. They are both inclusive. So it is a system in which intrinsic factors, extrinsic factors, the nature of species and the nature of area, they all govern the success of invasion. In India, now I am coming to the second aspect of it. In India, we have introduced many plant species. Now I am focusing only on plants after this general introduction. Most of the plants we have introduced for economic gains or for beautifying, ornamentation, ornamental values. Some like eucalypts, poplars, you must have seen these plants. They were introduced in this area. You know, eucalyptus was brought in 1790 by Tipu Sultan, king of Mysore. And from there it was brought in to correct the marshy character of the land. Marshy, you understand, pani zyada hai, water table high hai. To correct it, eucalyptus was brought in. People started saying that eucalyptus dries out the soil and it takes more water. I am not going in that discussion. I have worked on eucalypts also and I have proved that it is not true. I'll discuss later in discussion if you feel like. But these are the plants which were brought for meeting our own interest. Likewise, some of the plants were introduced for their beauty, ornamental value. They later became invasive and weedy. While others like Parthenium and Eupatorium, these invaded our area accidentally. Although people have many stories about Parthenium, I have worked on Parthenium as well. Parthenium has not been brought by man, it has come to India. People say it came with PL480 food grains. That also is a myth, not a reality. We can discuss later. Mycenae, it was introduced in the Second World War to camouflage the army. Topiyon ke upar, jism ke upar, they will tie this, you know, climber, and they will fight. It is from there that it invaded the whole of Southern Asia. Then Parthenium, it came here, they say in 1950s, but I doubt it, because in the Calcutta Museum, this herbarium, you can find a sheet, few sheets of Parthenium dating back to 1890. Even in Brandes, he collected it, and in the FRI herbarium, the sheets are available in 1818. So, I don't indulge in that discussion because the topic is different. Likewise, Lantana, it was brought in 1809 by Lord Cornwallis to the Calcutta Botanical Garden. And from there, it escaped, and now it is a worry for the government. Likewise, Ageratum, it was introduced before 1882. We do not know. But presumably, because of its beautiful colored flowers, now it is a major worry. You know, invasion of alien plants in India is more disturbing. Why? Because India is one of the 12 sites of origin of species in the world. And India, at the same time, is a site of 4 hotspot zones. Books mein aapke 3 likha hoga. Ek this Sunda land is another hotspot zone, which has not as yet been recognized by MAB, UNESCO, but government of India has declared it a hotspot zone, Sunda land. And you probably know, hotspots kinko kaha jata hai? Those areas where we need more attention. Why we need more attention? Because these are the areas with endemism. Endemic species are there only in those areas. Nowhere in the world except that area, those species are available, and the number has to be more than 3,000. It means at 4 places in India, there are species which are endemic, more than 3,000 at each place. And the second is where the rate of extinction of the species is more. That is why the global intelligentsia, they say that pay more attention to this hot spot. This is very hot. These species will be over, and they will be over for times to come. We will lose them. Therefore, it is an issue of more worry for us. We have lot of endemism. Nowhere in the world those plants are available. If they get extinct, why they will get extinct? Because we have hot spots. The rate of extinction is very high. Therefore, jitna world ka biologist hai, environmentalists, they are focusing on India. That is why I say that if some of you can take up these aspects for your research, your growth is confirmed. We do not know, you know, if you look at this is India, how many types, percentage of invasive plants have come from which area? Majority are from Southern America and northern part of South America. Southern part of North America and northern part of South America. That is the range from where about 55% of the plants have come to India. And it is a big number, 55%. I do not know the reasons. Maybe this is on one side of the globe, the America is on the other side of the globe. Latitudinal, longitudinal areas matching, climatic conditions relatively matching. And then there is more of interaction between the nations. So here, I miss to say, there is no such known figure where we can know that how many of the plants are invasive alien plants. We do not know. There is only one paper ready 2008. It says 173 from this many genus and these many families. But it is not based on scientific evaluation. Reddy is a forester, IFS forest, and they didn't do it in that scientific manner. But being the only record with us, right or wrong, I cannot say it is wrong. I have not evaluated. Now, of course, we are doing it. The government of India has assigned me a task, and a 5 crore research project has been given to me on the Himalayan track, all the 12 states of Himalaya. We have just started about 3 months back, 500 crore project, to know the total load of invasion, the types of species, the path from which they come. How can we, you know, preempt ki yahan par invasion, yahan par plant hai, ab yahan aayenge. Risk assessment. So these aspects we are now trying to do. And it was really not that easy for me to identify labs. And the young teachers, young scientists, because working in Himalayas is not easy task. So we could get 7 labs, and those 7 labs are now started working, and we are monitoring that. Then, you know, the reasons why this invasion is fast, enhanced tourism, I think you can add a few reasons as well. These are all concocted reasons I have put in like this. Commercial exploitation and fast economic growth, better transport facilities, industrialization, anthropogenic activity, plantations and mining. Then interplant interactions, allelopathy. It is the allelopathy I started working with. When I found that a plant, Parthenium, is going here, why other plants are going away? I applied chemistry to it, evaluated the types of compounds I analyzed, and I used those compounds to work on other plants. It worked very well. So these compounds, they are in the environment. Allelopathy is interaction between plants. One plant releases certain chemical substances into the environment, and these chemical substances through the environment impact on the other. What we do, we collect the soil, bring out chemicals, analyze them, purify them, and if the purified chemical is available in the market, we use those compounds and test them. Likewise, we collect those which are volatile compounds, we suck the air in carbon tetrachloride, and the compounds we get analyzed. We collect from the topsoil also those volatile compounds. And then from the leaves or from the soil, we take the soil and take out material. Or the dead matter, we take out these compounds, they get degraded with the passage of time through light and environmental conditions. So the degradation products also we check. And based on it, what I could conclude that this allelopathic reason is a strong reason for the plants not to allow others to grow nearby. You know, I give example, let us say I don't brush my teeth, I don't change my dress, paseena aaya hua hai, garmi lag rahi hai aur badbu aa rahi hai. I sit in a bus, will anybody sit near me? Nobody will. So that is what these plants are doing. Their secondary metabolites, which are not good for them, they want to get rid of those secondary metabolites. They are thrown out in the open. And other plants, they find it difficult to stay there. So, exclusion principle. There is one thing called competition. Both the competing partners, they are trying to draw more from the environment. Here, one of the partners is trying to release certain chemicals because of which other plants they go away. This is different from competition. So I believe that this also, I have published many papers on reasons of invasion through allelopathy. Climate change is also one of the reasons. You can dwell on it. Then generally, the invaders being devoid of preferred predators. Jo plant America se aaya, uske predators nahi aaye. Who will eat them? So these plants, they will flourish. If a Japanese come here and says everything, does everything wrong and say that it will happen like this, you will admit it. So this is again a reason why there is fast growth of invasion. When I just said that I was given this task of working on impact of invasion in Himalayas in 2001 by the Ministry of Environment. I took up that big award and I was paid maximum salary in the country, and that was tax-free, equivalent to that of cabinet secretary, tax-free for 2 years. Lot of money, lot of recognition. But when I started working on it, I had this research associate working with me. I found that it is very difficult, not possible for an individual to do it. Reasons: 4 seasons. In each season, the diversity will change. And biodiversity, I had used the word biodiversity, not the plant diversity. And even in the plant diversity, not the terrestrial plants. You know, lakes bhi hain, water bhi hai, animals hain, that also covered in biodiversity. Then seeds, spores, all these things. Zameen ko khodun, seeds nikalun, spore nikalun, kahan tak karun? Aur phir, jo plain hai, uski jo surface area is more. Total area, land area may be less. Surface area is more. Then the climatic variations, top pe kuch hai, niche kuch hai. So I got afraid ke mujhe laga ke meri naak kat jayegi. People will say ke apne aap ko bahut bada ecologist bana raha hai aur biodiversity theek nahi ki. I wrote back to the government that it is difficult for me to do it. I surrender. Then the chairman of the committee, he said, no, we understand these problems. You carry on with it. Whatsoever little you are able to do, we welcome. With, you know, pure tan man dhan se, then I worked on it and came up with good results. So there I found that in the whole of Himalayas, in 2005, when I worked, the native plants were around 90%. Earlier in 1990, about 15 years back, they were around 95%. This shattered me. That almost 5% increase is a big increase. Now it must be much more. This is what was my study area. 15,000 quadrants we laid, I think you understand, I'll be going ahead. You know, these are the types of plants. Majority were from North or South America. What we found that these three, Agilatum, Parthenium and Lantana, these three were about 70% of the exotic plants in the state. Major component was from these three plants. And they constitute around 10% of the whole vegetation. This is also enormous. Then, you know, how they do, very hurriedly I'll go through. There is a seed bank in the area in which the plant comes. And these plants, they will have large number of seeds, small seeds, large number of seeds. Even if 99% they die out, 1% is enough for the area to dominate, these plants to dominate. So their survival, they germinate and sprout depending on the type of climatic conditions and the situation. And all this competition, adaptability, absence of natural enemies, allelopathic defense, they all will establish. And they will complete their cycles and ultimately they will increase their number. I think you have seen this plant in plenty. This is from Chandigarh area. It is even in the agricultural fields. Wherever it goes, it makes its unending kingdom. There is a famine for fodder. Cattle, they don't feed on it. Insects, they don't eat it. So they keep on flourishing. They have wide ecological amplitude. Ecological amplitude is a technical term. Means those conditions on which the plant can very well survive. You know, amplitude from temperature, let us say 5 degree to let us say 50 degree. It's a wide temperature. Or pH, soil pH, wide it can withstand. So likewise, wider the ecological amplitude, better the adaptability. Understandable. So it completes its life cycle in 6 to 10 weeks, depending on the climatic conditions. Germinate and survives throughout the year. You know, its spread is through air, through transport, double spread. That through wind as well as through water. You might have heard about this Parthenium problem, this initiated from Pune. There is a paper of Vartak, and this was published by Dr. R. R. Rao, who was in Hyderabad, now he is in Bangalore. R. R. Rao, he is fellow of Academy. So Mr. Pranjpe, an engineer, PWD engineer, he notices in a heap of garbage in Pune and he gave it to Vartak. He identified it is Parthenium. For the first time in 1956, it was noticed. For a few years, it remained in obscurity, not known to many people. In 70s and 80s, it grew. You know, jaise hota hai na, there is a sigmoidal curve of growth, you understand. Initially, there is a lag phase, slow growth, and when the growth came up, then there is a plateau. From 1956 till 1970 or 80s, it was in the lag phase, slow growth. And in 80s, after 80s, completely. You know, now in India, every state has Parthenium. You know, these, I think you are able to see these hair-like growth. We call them as trichomes. Agar nahi dekha to kisi plant ko dekhna, check it, you will find it on the surface. These trichomes, they are full with parthenin. Parthenin is a chemical substance. And this is sesquiterpene lactone, a dangerous substance, which these trichomes, they are in the air. These trichomes, they stick to our body. Forehead pe, skin ke upar, open arms ke upar, they will stick. The parthenin will get into the body, into the skin. There is an itching of the skin, thickening of the skin. And photosensitization means during daylight, people start itching it and khurkte hain, or you know, to the extent that two boys, one in Karnataka and one in this Andhra, they committed suicide because they could not bear the itch. Even the cattle, when cattle is fed on parthenium, there is a problem of kidney, muzzle, the mouth parts, there are ulcers. And even parthenin comes in the milk of cow or buffalo or cattle. It means this parthenin does not get degraded. So we worked even on this aspect also. There are degradation products. We fed it to earthworm. Earthworm, you understand. So in vermicomposting, you can do these simple experiments. And these are, you know, काफी अच्छा पेपर निकलते हैं आपके. So we fed it to parthenium, this earthworm. Earthworm का जो fecal droppings निकली, they didn't have parthenium. But the cells, we dissected the earthworm also. We tried to find out if either the parthenin has been absorbed in the inner lining of the cell, or it has been degraded, and degraded product should come. We could not. I am not a chemist. Chemists can do it far better. If you can come out with the degradation products, or it is in the intestine, I am just trying to, you know, find some person who can work on this, zoologist. We can extract parthenin, all the degradation products, because in the gut of parthenin, this earthworm, there are enzymes which can degrade parthenium, or which allow the absorption, we do not know. But the problem is there, that this parthenium, if is not degraded, that is why it comes in the milk of cattle. If it gets degraded, then we should try mechanisms for degrading parthenin and solving the problem of feed of the cattle. You know, these things, why it is competitive ability is more, cattle, they don't find grass to feed on. Then, you know, it disturbs the food chain, trophic level. These type of problems in the skin of man, these are all associated, because with this, the Zygogramma bichlorata, you know, it is from South America. People say, why in South America there is no problem of parthenium? Why nobody's come up with the problem of itching on account of parthenium? Simple reason, there is mechanism of control. Zygogramma bichlorata, it is a beetle which eats on parthenium. We imported this beetle from Mexico. In Bangalore it was imported, and we took it in Chandigarh also. I was against it, but administration did not agree with me. They introduced Zygogramma. This Zygogramma ate away the leaves of parthenium. After parthenium was over, they went to sunflower in the agricultural land. So it was a problem, and then the ICAR, they had to, you know, initiate a full-fledged team of controlling zygogramma from Ludhiana and Jalandhar and this Punjab Haryana area. Because when we imported zygogramma, it is again an exotic insect. The pest of this insect we did not. You know, the whole food chain is there. We ignored that. So the problem is where it was. You know, this is the result. What we did, the control area and invaded area. An area, state, or the district in which Parthenium is more. We try to analyze the diversity indices. And the area in which it is not seen, nearby area, there also we tried. So this is the difference. You can see the change. You can see here. Agilatum is another. The same thing. It is now, you know, this Parthenium has gone from south to north. Agilatum has gone from north to south. Now it is throughout the country. This also native of tropical America, spread to Korea, Japan, China, India, etc. It grows through stolons also, as well as through seeds. Seeds are very minute. They can be blown by air. So being an ornamental, initially one doesn't mind it, its growth in the agricultural field. But soon thereafter, in the next year, in 3 years' time, the whole area is full. I didn't know about this plant. Ministry of Environment called me once. Okay, there is a question in the parliament. Have you heard of this? In Palampur area in Himachal, the agriculturists, they abandoned their land and they call it Ujadu. Ujadu in Himachali, they say, Ujar deta hai, khatam kar deta hai. They said that there is a plant called Ujadu. Kindly visit Kangra Valley and give your report. I went there, I saw, I discussed with people. Real problem. And thereafter, in 3 or 4 years to that, in Chandigarh, in Haryana, everywhere I found it. So this also doesn't allow other plants to grow. The agricultural yield goes down. Again, the problem, the reasons are the same, number of seeds and etc. Found on the roadsides, these things I have, you know, it also replaces the grasses in pasture. Reasons are enormous seed production and high regeneration potential. Regeneration potential means in wide ecological amplitude, and it can grow through seeds, it can go through stem cuttings, it can grow through stolons, different means, and it can survive. This is again the same which I discussed with as regard Parthenium, they are the same. They belong to the same family also, Asteraceae, compositae family. Problems associated, almost the same. You know, causes hindrance in plowing, deteriorates crop quality, replaces other vegetation, health hazards, etc. There also the same results you can find. Then third is Lantana. I am talking of so far about Himachal. This also, same problem. This Lantana now is a weed, noxious weed, declared in 80 countries of the world. 80. You know, this National Science Foundation, NSF, they had invited me to this Florida in USA. They wanted me to have a collaboration on certain such plants which are in international scene. They wanted Maluka, which is not a problem with us in India. I said, no, I will not work on Maluka. If you want to work, let us work on this Lantana. You know, the problem is that if I control, let us say, Parthenium or Lantana from India, from Pakistan it will again come. From Sri Lanka or Bangladesh it will come, Nepal it will come. So I had initiated with the National Science Foundation that we should have a collaborative system wherein scientists from different countries, they should collaborate, focus on few plants, and we should control them. We should not eradicate. We should just control, control mechanisms. So they had their own interest in Maluka. I had my own interest in this lantana. I said no. Now, thereafter, I was successful in creating a task force, international task force, and this is operative. I am a member of that task force. But that task force is on biological species, all, including plants. So this also is a problem. The same, this belongs to family Verbenaceae. You know, this has come from this area to these areas. I am sorry that you are not able to see the lines which are going, growing from here, this area to the whole world. Lantana has gone. In India, it came in 19th century. Lord Cornwallis, as I just said. Here also the same issue, we found that these are the major plants. Then Aishornia, you might have seen this plant in the water bodies. It is very much there throughout the country. It is a noxious weed, problematic for the pond ecosystem. This also has come from South America, produces through runners and stolons. The Japanese were befooled in the Second World War. You know, you might have heard the name, the term, eco-terrorism, ecological terrorism, environmental terrorism. You know, send some such issues to the new area. You know, it is now an economic war, not through guns. So this also is one of the tools in the hands of those countries who believe in ecological war. So it chokes the waterways, promotes mosquitoes, best place for mosquito breeding, you know, stagnant water, and they proliferate. So control is very difficult in the water bodies. If you you know, Punjab government asked me, Dr. Kohli, can you suggest some ways of means of controlling this Aishornia from the lakes? I started thinking and I said, no, I'll not be able to. Because chemicals you can't use. There is a lot of fauna, aquatic fauna. Then I suggested that it has to be manual. Then the army was given a task of bringing out this and sending it for paper pulp preparation. They were successful, but after 3 or 4 years, again the same problem, it is there. Then Chinopodium murale, you must have seen this, Bathu we call it. In Chandigarh, it was lot of Chinopodium murale. When Parthenium came, Chinopodium murale was gone. You know, competition between the invaders also. Then Tagetes minuta, Asteraceae family. People say this enhances the mood enhancer. In Himachal Pradesh, tourist spots, they have planted this Tagetes. We told them that don't do it. This will escape from your area and it will create problem. And now it is a problem. Tagetes minuta, troublesome weed. Then Cromalina, Eupatorium, in the first slide also I said about it. This is a very strong allelopathic plant, aggressive competitor. It came into India in 1925. It also causes allergy, asthma to some people. Mycenia macrantha, as I just said, it was brought in to camouflage the army. And wherever this climber climbs on trees, usko pura shade out kar deta, thick shade out, tree has to die because there is no photosynthesis from the leaves of that tree. And the ground also, no photosynthesis, dark ho jata. if you want to see this, go to this Shillong area and northeast area. Even in Chandigarh area, it has come. Jatropha, you have heard this name, biodiesel. And they say it is green gold. Hamare jo bhutpurv rashtrapati Abdul Kalam, he had given the term green gold. People started growing it. Dangerous plant. Chinese, they came to India. They wrote me, Dr. Kohli, we want to see your president is saying, talking a lot about it. Aapne plant kiye hain, we want to come and see. I said, all right, you come. They came. I also visited them. Huge tracts, they also planted Jatropha. I told them, after a year when I again went, I told them, kya blunder you have committed. You will repent later. Now they are repenting. You know, these are all exotic plants. We invite them for our own trouble. Indian plants are far better. Pongamia, it is a tree, small tree. Pongamia, aapne dekha hoga. Full of oil. Better than this oil. Why can't we grow Pongamia? It will give us better yield, better quality, better amount, and lesser land cover. Prosopis. Gujarat has declared it as a state menace. Noxious plant. Anybody who propagates it can be fined. This has changed the forest land into Prosopis land. You can see this is all from this Gujarat area. It was brought in to stabilize the sand dunes. After its stabilization, it is good because erosion of land, the soil, that has to stop. So based on it, from there it escaped the whole state, not only the state, the whole country. Now in Punjab, this Central University of Punjab at Bathinda, this is a major problem with us around area. Hibiscus from Bangalore area, it is now growing. It is a new invasive plant, Hibiscus. Likewise, this Zephyrhanthus in Botanical Garden, Punjab University, Chandigarh. It came in. When I was chairman of the department, I saw it and I gave instructions to the workers there that you have to plow the whole land, remove it. For 2 or 3 years, I could save. Now again, last month I visited, full with Zephyrhina. You know, the whole land, grasses dikhte nahi. But look at the land surface, looks good, yellow, green, yellow flower and green leaves. But this spoils the diversity of the area. Algimon mexicana is another such weed. Now come to the some part with the trees. You know, this Eco Task Force of the global IUFRO, International Union of Forestry Research Organizations, it is the biggest organization in biological systems. And there I was, I initiated this program of invasion ecology. And from there, for 10 years, I was the chairman of that system, five years, two terms. And when I was to leave the term, I approached the presidium there, international body, to tell them that now we have come, you know, these books were produced and people were made aware. So a lot many people started interest in this invasion ecology. So I told them that we should have some international collaborations, and they initiated with a task force. in that task force, you know, people for working on fishes, working on insects, working on forests, different, some people working on economics of it, some sociological angles. So I was given the task of trees and shrubs. So I worked for 2 years on this aspect. And I realized that this is more important than even the plants, because the reason is that they are large sized, long lasting, ecologically dominant. Dominant, I think you understand. Their ecological value is more than a small plant. So difficult management. They have a very large seed base and biomass. So this results into drastic changes in the community structure. Inka litter fall bhi zyada hoga, leaves will fall, the diversity loss zyada hoga. So from that angle, I looked at the distribution of invasive trees in the world. My task was not only India, I was to work for the whole globe. So while doing so, I found how many types there are of. There are data wide which people have different figures to share. But when I counted based on the research publications, not simply by saying somebody that is invasive, people do not know much what is invasion and what is exotic. So they simply write in their, you know, websites that this is also invasive. I don't treat them as right. So based on my own scientific workout, I worked out 140 types. You know, these 140, the number of families and the total number of species, it comes to, there is only one, you know, from gymnosperms, there is only one Pinaceae family, the trees of which are invasive. Otherwise, gymnospermous trees are not invasive. Then, you know, looking at how they spread, categorization of invasive trees on the basis of propagule for spread. You know, they can spread through seeds, they can spread through cuttings, they can spread through flowers, they can be taken by man. There are many ways, vectors kai ho sakte hain. You know, viviparity, rhizomes and seeds, fruit and seeds, likewise, this is the distribution. Maximum is through seeds. And in most of the cases, this is for ornamental reasons or usefulness. Kisi ki timber achhi hai, isliye import it. And once you import, they will invade. So likewise, eco restoration ke liye, it is only 6%. Ornamental value is 38% and 56. You know, this 56 and 38, you need to club together because it is by interest of man. Then nativity of the alien species, continent-wise. You know, majority is AS stands for Australia. This AS stands for Asia. America AM. Australia is AUS. So Asia and Australia, majority of them. And then, of course, America. The trees of these continents, they have grown to different paths. This is vectors for dispersal. Ocean currents, insects and birds, birds and bats, man and other animals, only animals, birds, animals and man like this. So only birds, 26 tree species. Then it was a task, difficult task for me to find out the paths. You know, if I say that Pakistan se yahan aa gaye, these boundaries are political boundaries. These are not ecological boundaries. So therefore, one doesn't recognize political boundaries when we talk of invasion. We have to look for ecological boundaries. So ecozones, aap agar Google search karoge, ecozones mein, you will find these 7 ecozones. So this is number 1, color, number 2, number 3, 4, 5, 6, and Antarctica region is Oceania. So I try to look at the origin. It was an exhaustive study, although the secondary data with me, exhaustive secondary data. So I could find out that these ecozones 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, the species native of 40 species which are native of this area, they have gone exotic, alien for other areas. So other areas, in which areas, how much they spread. Some of the species, they can go to different ecozones. So their total number may be more than 40. So likewise, I could find that in these areas, Oceania is the minimum. Otherwise, 105 to Arctic. Arctic is this. You know, between this and this, or with this and this, there is more of exotic invasion interaction. This is, then I prepared the whole list. I have sent it for publication. It has not as yet been published. So this is how they go, this whole table. I am not showing the whole of it, just the way I try to depict it. You know, like acacia, one of the species. Different regions, you know, mostly these acacias are from this area, but some are of African or Asian origin also. So these three are going from here to these places. Some, of course, from here they are going. Likewise, Oceania. In Chandigarh, it is now a big problem. The Punjab University, behind it, was an area where this Oceania came. And we were very excited to see this plant because no two leaves are of same type. Phenology is different. So we were excited and we worked on it. After 2 years of that, the whole area was full with Oceania. And not only that, even the Botanical Garden of Punjab University, this came in. And it is a big task for the organizers of that garden now to uproot it. So this also spreads very fast and it is good for paper. And Japan se aaya paper mulberry isko kehte hain, golden mulberry or paper mulberry. Dalbergia siso is an Indian tree. And it is a havoc, creating havoc in America. It is not that hum bahut sant aadmi hain, kisi ko invade nahi kiya, we also invade. To sum up, India has become favorable abode for invasives for reasons, very good reasons. We always appreciate those reasons, but here these reasons are not good. One, that we have a large land area. You will be surprised and feel bad when I say that of 329 million hectares of land, which is arable land, where plants can grow, 184 million hectares is degraded, unattended. You know, more than half of it is degraded. We are very poor managers. I was talking to one parliamentarian the other day, a week ago. Maine kaha, do cheezon ko agar aap control kar lo, koi bhi government aati hai, nobody gives damn to soil and water. These two things, if we are able to manage well, India can support the whole world. You know, look at the location of India. Biggest peninsula, closer to equator, three sides samundar, pahar, you know, Himalayas, tall, you know, Himalayas, and laden with snow. Snow melts. Where does water go? It is fresh water, mind you. Where does water go? Water climbs down towards ocean. Network of rivers of fresh water is good with us. Every year there are flood scenes. We have not been able to manage. That is the issue. And Imagine if you search Google, the desertification means all those conditions which cause creation of desert, India is at number one. You know, look at it, so pathetic. The amount of mineral elements, it is not just for sake of saying, I am saying, you search it. The amount of mineral elements in the form of manure and fertilizers we add in the agricultural land, more than that gets eroded with soil erosion to the rivers and to the ocean. And look at the manpower, aur kuch nahi hamare paas, muscle power to hai and intellect is good. Even US, the every country, they say that Indians are good analysts, they are hard working, they have good language skill. We get employed. It is also a part of invasion. You know, this Silicon Valley, kya cheez hai? Bare hue hain Indians. They need man. That is why we are there. Why can't we focus on our own country? These reasons, because we have different climatic conditions. You know, weather conditions hamare paas, kadake ki sardi aur kadake ki garmi. Kadaka, you understand? Very severe. No country in the world has so much of variation of diversity in climatic conditions as we have. Cultural diversity, we have. You know, we are so good. I challenge anybody, compare karke dekho. Management part nikal do, resources compare karke dekho. Mineral resources per unit area, huge. We have not been able to manage them properly. That is why we are getting invaded. And these plants, you know, hum jab jate hain kahin par bahar videsh jayenge, and we will say, oh, this is very good, this is beautiful, few seeds we will put in and bring it. Little realizing that we are putting a seed of invasion. Hamare ko apne andar santushti nahi hai ki hamare Indian plants are so good. Chandigarh mein, when this conservator of forest, he came, mujhe milne aaye, maine kaha bhai Mr. Ishwar Singh, ek kaam karna, do not allow exotic plants to be planted in Chandigarh. Usko, I gave him a lecture, he understood it, and he made a policy कि हमने एग्जॉटिक ट्रीज नहीं लगाने, एंड दैट पॉलिसी इज स्टिल देयर. सो यू नो ऑल दीज प्लांट्स, यू हैव सीन दीज प्लांट्स, दे इंसिडेंटली ऑल फ्रॉम ट्रॉपिकल अमेरिका. मैंने इसको कैटेगराइज करने की कोशिश की, व्हाई इन इंडिया अमेरिकन प्लांट्स आर मोर. सो एलियन ट्रीज इन्वेजन फ्रॉम एंड टू अवर इंडो मलायन इको जोन हैज बीन relatively less, but overall damage has been more and fast. This is also a conclusion of my study. Then these have not only displaced the native plant species, but also deteriorated the quality of native ecosystem. Plants like these, Brocinacea, ye sare jo hain, ye new invasives. My request to the government, Ministry of Environment, is ke jitne new invasive plants hain, उनको निप द इवल इन द बड, अभी कंट्रोल करें. जैसे कि बताओ कहाँ है, अब कैसे बता दूं कहाँ है, लैब में बैठ के तो नहीं पता लगेगा. आई विल हैव टू गो टू द फील्ड, इंडिविजुअल आई कैन नॉट. सो दैट इज व्हाई वी नाउ हैव ए मेजर प्रोजेक्ट. चैलेंजेस बिफोर अस, वी नीड टू डेवलप नेशनल डाटाबेस फॉर IAS. IAS, मिनिस्ट्री बड़े हंसे इसके ऊपर. आई सेड दिस इज द सेम थिंग, इंडियन एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव सर्विसेज, हेयर आई एम रेफरिंग टू दीज इन्वेडिंग एलियन प्लांट्स. यू नो वी नीड टू हैव ए नेशनल डाटा बेस, वी डोंट हैव इट. कोई मेरे से पूछे भाई इतने सालों से काम कर रहा है बताओ कितने प्लांट्स हैं आई डोंट नो देन वी नीड टू असेस करंट स्टेटस ऑफ नेशनल बायोडाइवर्सिटी स्ट्रेटजी एंड एक्शन प्लान ऑल्दो वी ऑल से नेशनल बायोडाइवर्सिटी बोर्ड्स हैं बट दे नेवर एड्रेस दीज इश्यूज देन वी नीड टू ऑगमेंट द एग्जिस्टिंग कैपेसिटी फॉर कंट्रोल एंड रेगुलेशन ऑफ IAS स्पेशली एट द एंट्री पॉइंट ऑफ इंडिया एट एयरपोर्ट्स एंड सी पोर्ट्स I am thinking, agar aap mein se young boys and girls, if you can think of a problem, jitne bhi humare airports hain, airports mein koi individual cannot go outside and cannot plant any plant, cannot spray any, you know, seeds. Wahan par bhi invasion to hai. How come there the foreign propagule, foreign seed has come into? It is a need. We need to know कितने plants वहाँ पर invade कर चुके हैं I believe the number will be far less than what is outside because outside it is the man who is the culprit there man cannot go therefore the number is less but you need to seek permissions from the airport authority of India I am pretty sure वो ministry को पूछेंगे ministry कहेगी yes go ahead कोई एडवाइजर एडवाइजर आपको दे देंगे कर लीजिए देन यू नो नीड टू सीरियसली डेवलप साइट रेडिकेशन प्रोसीजर्स मल्टी ईयर ग्रोथ यू नो दिस पार्थिनियम आपको पता ही है जो चंडीगढ़ में था आई वॉज वर्किंग ऑन इट एंड आई डिवेलप्ड एक सोल्यूशन बाय वे ऑफ विच द प्लांट कैन ईजिली डाई एंड द सोल्यूशन वॉज नथिंग बट इट्स ओन टॉक्सिक कंपाउंड्स ऑटोटॉक्सिसिटी आई प्रूव दैट इट इज ऑटोटॉक्सिस अमेरिका में हमने इसको पब्लिश किया था वाइस चांसलर आस्क्ड मी के डॉक्टर कोहली गेट रिड ऑफ पार्थिनियम फ्रॉम द कैंपस आई सेड ऑल राइट आई विल डू इट कहा जी कितने पैसे लगेंगे आई ट्राई टू इवेल्युएट द एक्सियन ऑफ द यूनिवर्सिटी ही केम टू मी डॉक्टर कोहली क्या कर रहे हो आर यू श्योर दैट पार्थिनियम विल नॉट कम बैक I said, I am sure that it will come back. How can I say that it will not come back? Then he said that why should we spend money? I said, all right, don't do it. Then there was a task force, Parthenium Eradication Task Force of the government of Chandigarh. I was chairman of that committee. I prepared a whole cycle that in a year, for 2 years, if Chandigarh does it, Parthenium will be eradicated. Simple issue was that we need to put the land to use. Wherever land is in use, Parthenium will not come. I proved it, experimentally proved karke dikhaya inko. They agreed. They started with it, but soon the administration at the top level of Chandigarh, they changed. Same problem stays. But it is not that we cannot control it. We need to have the real interest in controlling it. And it is not expensive as well. Then effective mechanisms for mass removal of IAS from PA network, protected area network. Pata hai protected area networks? Desh mein, there are many protected area networks jis mein biosphere reserves aate hain, sanctuaries aati hain. और नेशनल पार्क्स आते हैं नेशनल सेंचुरीज नेशनल पार्क्स एंड बायोस्फीयर रिजर्व्स दे कम अंडर दे फॉर्म प्रोटेक्टेड एरिया नेटवर्क सो उसमें से कम वी नीड टू रिमूव इन्वेसिव प्लांट्स देन वी नीड टू प्रमोट इंटर सेक्टोरल लिंकेजेस टू चेक अनइंटेंडेड इंट्रोडक्शंस कंटेन एंड मैनेज द स्प्रेड ऑफ IAS यू नो जितने ये इंपोर्ट करते हैं ना ऑल दीज नर्सरी मैन दे सेल सीड्स They need to be educated. Then restoration measures should be upgraded. Jitne bhi degraded areas ho gaye hain, restoration measures must be employed. Otherwise, this 184 will increase to, it is already more than 190 now, but there is no official figure with us. Way forward. Individually, it is not possible from my own experience. Second is, it demands long-term strategies and, of course, global partnership and collaborative joint actions. Cities ke andar bhi, states ki bhi, different states should join hands. Ek state se nadi jati hai, dusri state mein jati hai, to dono states must join hands. Likewise, national-wise, we need to formulate uniform, doable guidelines. Utopic sana banaye. The thing which can be done. And then we need to develop database, augment the existing capacities, develop regulations, you know, these things. We need to employ tools for early warning. This is what we are now doing. How we can identify that this plant is going to be a problem in the next year, next area. Risk assessment we need to do. Then we need to adopt effective site eradication procedures and initiate restoration measures. Based on our collaborative efforts, there is one NMHS, National Mission on Himalayan Studies. Advertisements by the Ministry of Environment aati hain. And throughout the country, people have fellowships. They have two types of work. Aapke liye important hai. Those of you who want to work in Himalayas may apply for research grant. This is one project. Those of the students who cannot have the research grant, they can have research fellowships. They have already awarded around 176 fellowships to the boys and girls who can take up the task in Himalayan region. So there is a STAGS, this special technical assessment committee. I am the chairman of that committee, and I always encourage jitna bhi young bacha aaye, I never refuse to a young person, because I know it is an investment in that child. Old people, they don't deserve. We government of India is pumping in a lot of money for research, and it is only for the young scientists, young people, we need to encourage and we need to nurture. So NMHS ki site pe jaakar dekhna, Ministry of Environment ki, usme you will find lot many other options with you. So we have now initiated this All India Coordinated Research Project on 12 states, and all these things which I shared with you, we are doing. We have just started. 3-4 mahine hue hain. Last monitoring committee I held in this Shillong. Next committee we are going to have in Chandigarh. Professor R. R. Rao is a member of that committee. He is a taxonomist. And Professor R. S. Tripathi from Lucknow. He is also a member of that advisory committee. So you can identify your own area. First, you should identify your own campus. Where in your own campus there are invasive plants, control them off. It will be a good contribution. In Chandigarh, we did it. Ye jo hota na, Adatoda. It is a native of India. So we removed lantana with the help of, you know, with our help, the government did it. And we threw the seeds of Adatoda. Lantana has not come back. Eco Task Force of Jammu region, they invited me. I was sent for inspection. They removed lantana from the whole area. Army walon ne to fir wo army wala kaam kiya na. And they planted trees. I asked them about a year back, ke ji lantana to nahi aaya wahan? Kehte hain, no lantana. So it is not that we can't do it. We only need to focus on it. And the young boys and girls of your age, those who are studying in good universities, they are more aware. They are organizing such colloquia. I expect from you some such challenging jobs to do. It will be a real contribution, and you will feel satisfied at the end of your career. You will feel satisfied that, oh, we have done good for the posterity to come. I think that is all. Thank you so much for giving me a patient hearing. You have questions, I'll try to respond to those questions as much as I can. You can have questions related to the topic, on the sidetrack of the topic, other than the topic.
Sir.
Yes.
Along with inhibitory effects, allelopathy. Inhibitory effects, allelopathy also has stimulatory effects on other plants. Means I have read about wheat and some sorghum species.
Sorghum, yes.
In which the roots exudes are stimulatory effects on other wheat species. So can we use such plants for to save our native flora? And
this is possible. You know, there are 2-3 aspects. ये जो आप सौरगम की बात कर रहे हो, इंद्रजीत का काम की बात कर रहे हो आप, रूट्स एक्सुडेट्स एंड ऑल दैट, यू नो देर आर फ्यू एस्पेक्ट्स. वन, मोस्ट ऑफ दीज एलिलोपैथिक कंपाउंड्स दे आर मोस्टली फिनोलिक्स और द डेरिवेटिव्स ऑफ फिनोलिक्स एंड दीज आर टॉक्सिक. टॉक्सिक नॉट एक्सक्लूसिवली टू ए पर्टिकुलर स्पीशीज, widespread toxicity. If we spray these toxins to the area, the plants will die out. Mm. Agreed. But the soil will also get polluted.
Okay.
You know, the insects or the microbes, soil is a living ecosystem, you understand?
Yes.
If it is a dead system, it is not soil. Soil has to have organic matter in soil, or has to have living biota in it. So that living biota we will have to compromise with. Second, some people they say that ye Mahadevappa group and from Bangalore area, that we should plant these plants so that the weeds they go away. Again, not a good strategy. For up, you know, controlling parthenium, people started with Cassia nodosa, a shrub. Cassia nodosa is itself an allelopathy, strong allelopathy plant. You remove one, invite another. Ek invader ko khatam karne ke liye kisi aur ki invader ki help li aur wo invader ban gaya. So these experimental lab scale experiments are okay. We have been doing, we have been suggesting. But with the element of maturity that I am getting, we need to do those aspects which are applicable in the field. Not at the lab scale. At lab scale it is possible. Okay? Could you understand the topic?
I have one.
Yes, yes, please, sir.
Are there invasive plants which originated in India and have gone out?
Yes, Dalbergia siso, I showed. Shisham, 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 shisham is Dalbergia siso. Then this coniza, this grass, invasive. And Large scale invasion. You know, there are research papers. There is one Shibu Jose who is working on Indian invasive plants in America. And good papers, I think around 16-17 papers.
So what we say culturally, we never invade any country, is not true.
No, not at all. It is not true. Deliberately we may not have. You know, intentionally we did not. But we have been invading you know, and not in large scale. You know, this Trump, why is Trump worried in USA? Because he feels that his own Americans, they are not getting jobs, and in competition, Indians, they compete well. Even in, you know, I was referring to my son, he's a doctor in USA. Whenever there is a newspaper cutting, you know, I take a click and send it to him. Maine kaha tera kya hoga kaliya? Kuch nahi hoga papa. They need doctors and they need good doctors. If we leave, they will be doomed. I told him ke bhai tere se bhi acche honge. You know, the place where he is now, wo Mayo Clinic mein uski interview thi, there were 21 doctors. 20 were Americans, he was the only Indian. He got selected. So, kehta hai, papa, dekho, inko to aata hi nahi kuch. So, they are allowing invasion, but they are worried about invasion.
Sir, my question is, you have talked about the Himalayan region.
About?
Himalayan region,
yes,
Shivalik,
yes,
and all that. It is very difficult to study there.
Why?
Because of lot of problems and whatever the spores form, they buried into the ice and all that. So I could not study well during the period of 2005.
Yes, I could not. Yes.
Yes. My question is, I'm more interested to hearing about the Rajasthan part, because related to IAS, invasive alien species of the plant, because Rajasthan having the lot of climatic diversity. And
yes, you are right.
Yes,
it is again a difficult task even in Rajasthan, but there the problem is localized in small areas, not widespread, because of sandy areas, sand dunes. But some of the trees like prosopis, even parthenium, wherever there is good amount of water, those plants which have a wider ecological amplitude, they go there, they acclimatize, and they create conditions suitable for them. They are possible, although it is difficult. But more concern is on Himalayas, because the whole Himalayan, you understand, it is, there are two hot spots there, Indo-Malayan region and the total Himalayas. And the government is worried, there is a pressure from the international agencies also. Ke bhai kya kar rahe ho? Invasion ke liye kya kar rahe ho? Biodiversity ke liye, we are already a part with the CBD, Convention on Biodiversity, and HE Convention 2021, we are to respond to them, that what are the efforts India has taken, you know, initiated. So in that context, Himalayan is more important, more so important, because if we are able to control ecology of Himalayas down the stream, it is not difficult. That is why there is more focus on it. In fact, when I initiated this proposal with the government, I initiated for the whole of the country. Wo kehte hain bhai nahi, country nahi, pehle aap itni badi chhalang mat lagao. You initiate with small unit. And then there was this NMHS program. So there, this was a, you know, they asked me to develop a proposal. It is a commissioned project. I didn't initiate. My initiation was for the whole country. Then I, being a member of that committee, the Secretary of Environment, he said, Dr. Kohli, aap isko karo. I said, all right. Then I talked people, different labs. Are you ready? We will give you so much of money. There are 7 labs. They agreed. It is a, you know, difficult task, but we are focused. Any other? So thank you so much. I enjoyed this. Maybe you understood. Thank you a lot. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for a very informative and interactive talk. I guess all of us have made a note of whatever you have spoken. And this topic, you told how it is important, and also with respect to research. I hope some of us will be working in this field. May I now request Professor S.R. Gadre to say a few words.
Yeah, we have heard. I'll just say a few words as a so-called mentor of this program. I work behind the scenes, and the real work is done by Avinash, who has run this show for many, almost 1.5 years now. We have heard a very nice talk from Professor Kohli. I know him personally for a few years by emails, more by emails than person. We have met, of course, few times. And he told a very fantastic story of invasive plants in India with beautiful pictures and a very live subject. So very, very fascinating story. And he has given you a message at the end that this is a very active area of research as well as work, actual field work to be done, and a lot of problems to be solved in the coming months, so years, maybe decades. So please take a cue from his advice. And those of you who have the fire in you to do things in this area, I think this lecture was a good beginning, and I hope you will take it up. In Science Club, we have been organizing lectures like this. The next talk will be by Professor Rajaram Nityanand. It will be physics, but doesn't matter. I think we all do science, and I hope many of you will turn up in big numbers on November 3rd November in physics department. So please, we would like to see some of these young faces there. So let me thank on my personal behalf and on behalf of Science Club, Professor Kohli, for a very inspiring talk that we heard. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, 1 second. Yeah, just one. During our last colloquium by Professor K.S. Valdia, we had collected the summary, and I would like to announce that there were two the best summaries that were identified. The first one was by submitted by Amita Pandey, MSc Chemistry first year student, and the second best was by Mr. Sunny Navrat from Department of Geology. So they will be given the prize during the next colloquium to be held on 3rd November. Thank you.
On behalf of the department, I would like to express my gratitude towards Professor R.K. Kohli for guiding us regarding alien plant invasion in India, their status and consequences in details. This talk would be helping us a lot for our further study, sir. Thank you very much. I would also like to thank Professor Avinash Kumar for taking the initiative in arranging the program in our department. Thank you, sir. I also thank Professor S.R. Gadre for his kind words. I thank the Vice Chancellor of Savitribai Phule Pune University, Professor N.R. Karmarkar, for his constant support. I owe a deep sense of gratitude towards the head of our department, Dr. Malpathak ma'am. I thank the teaching and non-teaching staff for their constant guidance and support. I also thank the members of Grey Eye Vision for the webcasting facility they provided to us. Last but not the least, I thank all the teachers and students present here for their cooperation. Thank you so much.